Hi, guys. So I am really excited to be on the faculty starting this fall with the launch of the Music Business Degree Program. This panel was inspired by the class that I am teaching that's called Building the Artist Team. And I see my students out there in the audience. And hopefully you guys have your stuff ready for that extra credit that we talked about. But anyway, it was inspired by that because they asked me to teach a class, just gave me a topic called Building the Artist Team. My background in the music business is as a manager and most recently also as an A&R. And I've also been very active in the live production side for creating shows that go on tour as well as television performances, award shows. So I've been lucky enough to wear different hats in this business, which made the concept of building the artist team a really easy topic to draw from my background, as well as, you know, just what I wanted to share with this next generation of aspiring artists, musicians, and executives. So this panel was inspired by building the artist team, and today we want to really take a look in depth at the creative part of the team, as well as how that interfaces with your marketing and business aspect of the team. One thing that I noticed in just coming up and reading books and, you know, kind of trying to find my way in the industry was that a lot of times team was just defined as the typical five people, you know, your manager, your agent, your, you know, business manager, and your publicist. And, you know, I think in a 2015, 2016 world where much of the artist development aspect has shifted to the do-it-yourself as well as really to management, there are a lot of team members that people kind of are skipping over the process creatively that really help create the best product out there, whether it's the best songs, whether it's the best live show, or just the concept of really artist development and having a really solid lane for yourself once you do venture out. And we are going to touch on as well, you know, the business team that you bring together, but the philosophy behind this approach to the team is how do you become a magnet for building that team? How do you create something that's so amazing, that's so solid, that as you go out there and you're networking and schmoozing, which is what everyone tells you it's about, who you know, but it's also about what are you going to say when you meet this person? What kind of email are you going to be able to send them to put together and present your package or your music? So, you know, that's kind of where we want to come from, and I'm really honored to have three people that I've known, that I've also looked up to, and who are veterans and, you know, really leaders in this business. So I'll have them come on stage now. Keep the applause going. So I am definitely going to let them get into giving you guys their backgrounds. But first, I kind of wanted to get a little sense of the room tonight. So who here is personally an aspiring, focusing on the artist, or not even aspiring, maybe you're already working, but are you in the artist lane? Raise your hand. Okay, great. Now, who here, and it could be the same people, but who is also pursuing a career as a songwriter and or producer? Alrighty. And then who here is looking more to go on the executive track behind the scenes, on the road, something of that nature, business side? Hey, Vincent, who wants to start a record label? He's in my class. Okay, and go on tour with his band. Okay, great. So, you know, it's great to have a diversity in the room, so all of this is going to apply to everyone. So I'll just briefly start out with Lorianne Gibson. She is a true innovator and leader as a creative director, but really beyond putting shows together, she's someone who's really also known for artist development, which is something we just touched on. And that often means you interface with the creative team members, which could be your A&R, which could be your producer, your songwriter, as well as the artist directly and really bringing that out of them. So all three of these people on this panel have really delved into working with the artist directly as well as interfacing with the team. But in her role, I'm going to let her go into it, but just she's held executive positions at record labels as artist development. You know, she's also directed music videos, which is a whole nother extension of your image and brand connecting with your live show. And she is really amazing. So she's also hired some of my clients before, so I really appreciate her. And no, she makes a lot of people a lot of money, so we'll say that. Next, we have Courtney Barnes, who is a publicist. Courtney is also a true veteran and industry leader behind the scenes, very much a person that you're not going to see because he's behind the scenes making everything happen, pulling the strings. Courtney represents some of the biggest producers, people that you guys are going to know that he's going to talk about, as well as artists, but is also very hands-on and integral with breaking new artists and is not afraid to give his opinion as a publicist to the rest of the team to know what's going to work out there and what's not going to work, which is very critical. Ben is one of the best A&Rs in the business that you guys will meet. He actually has been on the A&R side at a record label where he is looking at what is the best single to put out and putting together epic albums, but he's also been a publishing A&R where he is really a true creative individual himself in putting songwriters and producers together with the right artists and crafting songs, hit songs, and all through that he's been a manager as well, and he's truly worn all hats. So that's these guys. So I'd love to just present, you know, the panel and start off by saying I'd like everyone to just give a little bit, however much you want to give of your background or in the business, and then, you know, kind of a concept of like where you feel that your role and the artist team, what you've seen and kind of the positioning and just kind of an intro to what is the artist team.
Good evening. So, I mean, thank you, Lacey. That was really good. I just wanted to tell you that was good. So I started off as a dancer, Toronto, Ontario. I took a Greyhound bus to New York City where I studied at Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater. I then cut to going to a Heavy D audition and meeting Sean Puff Daddy Combs with a silver briefcase, and he handed me a card. He's like, hey, I'm A&R of Uptown Records. And I was like, do you know where the audition is? I remember still being dressed like a bunhead and dancing and auditioning for Heavy D, and it was Black Coffee, No Sugar, No Cream, and I got the job, and I remember showing it at Uptown Records the next day, and there was a girl named Mary J. Blige and, you know, a whole team of people, A&R publicists. But we were also a group of young people who had multiple levels of gifts, from great producers to songwriters, Jodeci, Mary J. Blige, Father MC, Heavy D, and of course, you know, Puff Daddy himself. So very early, it was about a team. It was about a family. Right now, somehow, the music industry is very about how much can I be better than. But what I came up in was how can we lift each other up, right? And we kind of all bound together and was really passionate about the music, the song, the record. So as a choreographer, very early on, I was drawn to the record, to the melody. How do we experience that song? How does an artist become that song? How do you affect the world? And when they see you perform it, how do they feel? And how do you leave them in a place where all they want to do is come back, right? How do I bring the record to life? How do I make you believe, like Bob Marley would say, get up, stand up, stand up for your rights? Like, how does that moment become the only moment that you're experiencing the record? You're in it with the artist. We become one. We understand how to experience a great song. And along with that comes, you know, how does an artist move? What is the body language? I mean, I tell everybody Elvis had great choreography, you know? Don't think that he wasn't very specific about when he would move his leg. He knew every time, you know? That is what choreography was. You know, I worked with Whitney Houston, and it was about when she opened her arms, you know what I mean? So, of course, Alicia Keys, how did she walk up from the piano and really show a certain comfortability so that she wasn't distracting the way you heard the record? Because when you looked at her, it was all on one accord, right? So when I ended up at Uptown Records, I very early saw in me that there was a gift of artist development. Motown Records is built on artist development. Once they were with the songwriter, they went into the studio, then they went and saw a man called Charlie Atkins, Temptations, Four Tops. Marvin Gaye was a drummer, he was a janitor. You know, there was a process at Motown that not only defined pop music, but really was the blueprint for it, yes? So I studied Charlie Atkins at Motown, and I realized the power of artist development. And now, more than ever, it is a season of, you can digitally download a record, but you cannot download an experience, you know? So after going through Uptown Records and Mary J. Blige and Missy Elliott and finding the Jonas Brothers and putting together all these different amazing people, and the list goes on, I wanted to do something new and innovative. So I met a young white girl named Lady Gaga, you know? And so for me, at that point, I really had studied and really had honed in on artist development and defining a brand and taking something from scratch and creating an experience. And I remember very early, I said, oh, we're gonna sell 10 million albums. And they told me we don't sell 10 million albums anymore. But of course, I was obsessed with Purple Rain. And I said, if I could somehow create a tour like that, what do you mean we can't sell 10 million albums? They're like, the record industry doesn't do that anymore. So that's when I started to really understand the experience. And if you went to the show and you heard the record and you felt the record and you saw the record, I could teach a generation again how to hear music and how to allow it to affect them. So I wrote The Monster Ball and so on and so on and so forth. So I think I do multiple things. Artist development is one stage, yes. So it's to develop the artist and pull out who they are as a result of the music and the message. Some people are manufactured. Some people don't have that depth, and that's fine too, right? But there's still rules to that game. You know, Britney Spears is an example of there's still a generation of pop artists that still have to follow a certain level of execution, you know? So there's a point where an artist will record a record or a songwriter will write the song, yes? And then it's a different experience live. You know, you may write something, but it feels different when you're singing it in a live atmosphere, when you're in that moment. How does your hand move? How do you become one with the message? Right? The physicality has to be one with what you're saying and the melody. And so at one point in time when an artist is developed to allow all of those things to work in tandem with each other, I call it the magic. It's a muscle. It's a certain place where as an artist, when you're in line with those things, it becomes purpose-driven, destiny. It becomes the things that have inspired you to come to this very school. You know what I'm saying? So that's what artist development is, taking that moment to understand how, when you write that song and you perform that song, how are you going to experience it from 5 people to 50 million people? And now, as a result of the music industry changing and the access to records, what I do is now not only pivotal, but the defining factor, I think, to the success of an artist. Because we've had access to records and songs and independence, and also like when you're at home and you have the power to cut up your image, it's a little bit self-indulgent. So you're cutting up something and you're putting things up online that you really haven't experienced in its fulfillment and its totality. So a lot of artists that are online creating their image is a little self-indulgent. Oh, I can cut this, or I can just do this, yes. And if I'm listening, I'm thinking you're a star and I'm experiencing you one way. And then when you go to the show, they're just standing there, or they're frozen, or they don't understand how to bring you into a zone, how to let that record rock. What's the order of your show? How do you not take me out of an album? When you create an album like Thriller, you create an experience. It's not just singles. What is that? Who are you? It's a moment in time where your first album has to reflect what that feels like. What am I birthing? What am I here sonically to make the world feel? Is it, what is it? What do I have to say? And in this moment, how can I take the songs I'm writing, the music I'm putting together, and how can I physically experience this body of work that I just spent 3 years putting together, you know? I think that now what I do, like I said, is truly defining. And of course, I worked with such amazing A&Rs, and I can go down the list, and they kind of really broke me in, you know, to understanding the power of an A&R. I think that's lacking in this industry. I think the thing about an A&R, they say artist relations, right? But it's about an ear. If you don't, you know, to work with a really great A&R is like freedom. You know? To see the songwriting process and to understand a real record man is what the music industry is about. And then to be able to work with someone who understands the details in experiencing that is what I do. So it's multiple things. Of course, it's artist development, then it's defining the brand, you know, and it's not putting my opinion on something, but it's pulling something out of that artist. You know, I always tell people if you could see what some of my artists are on day one, you would not believe, right? But I remember meeting Gaga and thinking, okay, what rhythm are you on? 1, 9, 10, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I was like, I'm going to have to figure this out right in this zone. I don't know where we are, girl, but we're going to find it. You know, now they just want to like choreograph, oh, hi-hat, snare. I'm like, the producers did a great job. Why are you just coloring by numbers? You know, so there's levels to this thing is what I'm saying. So as artist development, once you pull out how an artist is going to move, when they're going to move, when I was dancing with Mary J. Blige, I very early understood because she'd be crunched over, you know, searching for real love. I was like, is she going to move? You know, so I'd be choreographing live on stage, like, okay, a little bit drunk, okay. Stay down. We ain't moving yet. I love you now and now. I think we're getting ready. 5. Move. Searching for. So I found out where they would breathe, and I would start to begin to paint the movement based on what's. I love that you guys know that. It's that. It's the sizzle. It's the empty. It's a. So that you come back to the verse. You know what I mean? So I found that choreographically was my style, and it came out of artist development. So that's one job. Now as a choreographer, yes. Can I say that I'm a bad bitch? Okay, great, I said it. So as a choreographer, that's a separate thing, right? Once you develop the artist, you now have certain things to build. The first show, the promo tour. Right? The award shows, the television shows, the club shows. So you want to build it where it is what it is in the beginning, even though we were at a bar with two dancers. It felt like we were at Madison Square Gardens from the beginning. So there's a certain way to do that choreographically where the artist is still in control of their stage. It's not like, okay, you're Ariana Grande with a good voice and stuff, but honey, what's happening? I'm not feeling nothing. There's 90 dancers just moving behind you. Like, who are you? Why are they moving? Do you know what I mean? So then there's choreography, and then there is creative direction, which as a creative director, you're directing the creative. You're hearing the album. You're asking an artist, what's the title of your album? Blue sugar? Yes! Why is the sugar blue? So we have this collaboration, and it's about taking someone to a safe place, understanding the vulnerability, and really understanding why did we make this record in the first place? What is at the core of this? And whatever's at the core of it, then that's how it should look, and that's how it should feel. So as the creative director, I then begin to break down the whole experience. Well, what do you want to wear? I don't know, why'd Michael have the glove? He didn't just have the glove so that we would buy gloves later. Something about the way he rocked. Then we put a glove on it. You know what I mean? The disco stick was a cane that I found in the junkyard because I couldn't think of any more moves. I was like, what am I going to teach her? Okay, I know. I'll give her this cane, and it'll be the disco stick. And we'll take, like, a verse and a chorus. And y'all know what I'm doing. I got a red light, pornographic dance fight, systematic. Hey, but we got no money. Look, this is a lot of choreography I don't have to think of. It's still happening, girl. Point the disco stick at the world. No, we're still going. But there was a fearlessness to her that I knew was enough. Do you know what I'm saying? And someone else might have been like, you gotta do this, you gotta do this. No, you don't. Let the record breathe. Let the people feel it. Let them find out why you wrote it in the first place, yes? So then I would put a light in it. And later that light got bigger when we got more money. But my point is, now artists are like, well, what does my show look like? And I'm like, well, who are you? Let's just find out who you are first, rather than you tell me you want 5 lights and a disco stick. You know what I mean? So they've got that twisted. So when you're in that process and you're thinking about transforming and becoming, just remember to be authentic with the very reason and the very inspiration at the beginning of the journey. Because that's the tandem element to why you are you. And that's the very thing that will cut the market. Not that you become big because you do what everybody else is asking of you, but you hone in on the very thing, that unique thing, and then you do the work. So when you remain in that unique thing, you have the muscle to support it and to maintain that the entire time. Because that's a different feeling to be in the zone, right? So that's creative directing, is responsibility for the entire experience. You know, I wrote and directed The Monster Ball. I wrote and directed the Pink Print Tour. So it's now at a different level, you know, but I've also worked with the Dixie Chicks. You know, I put the Jonas Brothers together when they were 14. I work with Missy Elliott, reggae bands, rock bands, you know, just coming to the microphone, you gotta have, you know, there's no more Steven Tyler's, because what happens now is back then we could get on a bus and go on a club tour and work it out. Does anybody remember Prince's Controversy album when he had the, yes. So, you know, apparently in Detroit they booed him, you know, that's where the story goes. But now they have the camera phone. So the first time you go on the road, even to the rinky dinks to work out your system, they're filming you and they're judging you. So now you have to come to a person like me, or you have to take time to process this record live, to sing it out in a garage, to see what happens when you sing the words, get up, stand up, stand up for your rights. You have to let it sizzle and talk to the people. That just doesn't come after you write the song and get out the studio. So great A&Rs know this, and great publicists, I can't even just call you a publicist because you're everything, understand the process. And that is why when you told me to come here, I was like, I can't even believe there's a place where someone is trying to give you the information about the process. Overnight is an illusion, and it's attached to making money. It's not attached to making great art. But yes, we want to eat. But when you're great, it takes care of itself. So you got to remember, this thing might not happen overnight, but if you're rooted in it, and when it happens, then overnight is you. And that money and that fame and that thing is a different, separate beast. And if you're not built to win, then it will kill you. So all of these elements that what I do, all of these stages are necessary now more than ever, because we are in the future of music. It's not going to go back to Motown where the camera phone is no longer on. And you can digitally download that record and feel ego amazing and get 1,000,010 followers and all of that zhuzh. But when they come to zhuzh, sorry, it's one of my words. You know zhuzh, just meaning a zhuzh. It's what I say when I don't have a word. But when they come to see you, you have to be a transparent experience of the record so that they now can feel what they need to feel as a result of what you write and what you produce. Does that make sense? And if you're in your ego and you haven't taken that time to process it, then that's what they feel, if that makes sense. If you're just getting by and you're like, and you go do the show, then that's what you're reflecting. So if you don't do the work, then that's what your career is going to feel like.
Can I jump in real fast?
Yes, please, shut me up.
No. I actually wanted to go off of something you said that makes a lot of sense. Pardon me, Courtney, for... So it's actually, looking at it from an A&R manager's perspective, one of the hardest things to do, it's easier to get the fan to buy a single because it only takes one click on iTunes or one stream on Spotify where they're already plugged in. But you know how incredibly hard it is to get somebody to buy a ticket of $20, $50, $100 to go down to whatever the venue may be, whether it's the Troubadour or the Staples Center or anywhere in between. If to get them to even buy the ticket is incredibly difficult, but to get them there, once you have them there, don't fuck it up as an artist. And that's why what Lorianne's saying is so important. And I literally just got through this process with an artist that I was developing. I'm going to kick it back to you in just a second, but I just want to say that I really agree. It's like you can't just have the song. Although the song may be the starting point and the song may be arguably one of the most important things, you're not going to be a A-list artist or superstar if you can't really deliver on, you know, live. It's a complete difference between, I'm trying to think about a couple artists right now. I mean, you mentioned Ariana, or even like J-Lo, you know, or Mariah Carey. Well, I guess Mariah didn't really dance that much.
No, J-Lo danced. And she still came at the tail end of
the building still sustaining the artist process.
Correct.
You know what I mean? Like,
right.
Mariah was part of the last of the Mohicans. You know, we're talking about the music industry, where it is now and the future.
Right.
So, Rihanna's not really.
Yeah, she doesn't dance.
Oh, Rihanna. I thought you said Mariah.
I said Rihanna.
But the thing about Rihanna is she, too, came at the tail end of it. Because remember, I was there when Jay and L.A. were having private, they would have private shows for the new artists to get them in front of people, tastemakers, mm-hmm. in New York. Remember, the music industry was heavy in New York. Now we're all out in L.A. like, oh, God. Love you guys. I'm just saying. So all the labels were in New York. So we would go down and be like, and she was like one of the new artists. It was her and Neo. And I remember sitting beside Jay like, nah, I don't like her. And I was like, oh, shit, I missed that money. No, but it wasn't that. It was that. It was a different time. She caught the tail end of it as well and was protected by a system. But Rihanna is, to me, I mean, if I got her now, it would change her life and have a sustenance, and that's just me, not in a bad way, but feeling that. But she's probably the last perfect example of the A&R being the star.
She's a star.
Her records are stars.
Absolutely.
She's a great model. But her records, Honey Bunches of Oats, sustained. So, you know, there are options, but that's how I feel. That's a really good example about what you do and the love I have for a real A&R, because that's that artist, and nobody can catch her if she sticks to that formula.
Oh, okay, I was just going to say we were about to have a whole sidebar that we could come back to. But yeah, so Courtney, you want to go ahead and just intro and
reference.
I don't know where to go after that. I'm speechless.
You are never speechless. I mean, he's been my PR
publicist. Yeah. Till she fired me.
Honey. No, till you told me I couldn't talk about God so much.
Anyway, that's part of what I do.
Do you have to talk about your faith so much? Not in a bad way. He was like, look, girl, you can't be preaching to everybody in every interview.
So, anyway, I started a long time ago. I started in the early 90s, and I actually got into PR because at the time that I was trying to find a job in the music industry after college, that was the only job I could find. So it was never my intention to become a publicist, but the first job that I got was at a big PR firm with a big publicist by the name of Lee Salters. So I literally walked into a PR firm with Michael Jackson, Barbara Streisand, I'm trying to remember who else was there, Whoopi Goldberg, you know, all at their height as, you know, I was right there in the mix of everything. And the first job that I had was to place the phone calls from my boss and to read and send all of his faxes. So as a result of placing and receiving all the phone calls, I learned every single journalist of every level in the entire journalism business, from Barbara Walters would call to, you know, the smallest guy at the smallest little paper in, you know, wherever, you know, the Pasadena Star Ledger or something like that, Pasadena News. And so by reading everything and being there just as a sponge, I absorbed the whole business, not just the practical parts of being a publicist and overhearing his phone calls with managers who were and still are the primary people that hire publicists today, but really learning what Lorianne was talking about, which is the artist relations. I mean, I heard many, many, many arguments between Lee and Barbara Streisand. I mean, lots and lots and lots of them. I heard arguments with Lee and Whoopi Goldberg and with Dolly Parton. So, you know, just learning how to cater to an artist's ego and to massage them to get them to do, interviews and to develop strategies that were ultimately good for their image that they didn't necessarily want to do at that moment was, it's a skill. You know, it's not something that can be taught, but I mean, if you're there and you're listening in on the phone calls or you're right there next to the person that's making the phone calls, you do learn a lot and you will pick up things. So, you know, for any of you students out there, the thing that I would say that is most important, more than anything that you can learn here academically, is to go out and to get some real life experience by interning with somebody who is very, very experienced. And when you're choosing your internships, get with the most successful and the most experienced person that you possibly can in the field that you're interested in. Because in this business, there are definitely levels of everything. There's levels of A&R, there's levels of publicist, there's levels of everything. So you want to be with the best, because that's where you're going to really see the real inner workings of people that can really make a phone call and make something happen. Or you could be with somebody else who's making a phone call and making a lot of phone calls and absolutely nothing is happening on the flip side. So after I stayed with Lee for, I think I was there for three and a half years, started off as his assistant. And then one day in, I guess it was 1994, the guy who was, he was one of our heads of music, he decided that he was gonna quit. And all of a sudden, the Michael Jackson account was available. So I said, you know, I'd like for you guys to give me a shot on that, and I'll work really, really hard. So they said, okay, so we'll give you a shot on the Michael Jackson account. So I started working with Michael Jackson, I guess it would have been in probably the spring of 1994. And he was about to go on the Dangerous Tour, which was gonna go all through Asia and then come back to the United States. So about a month into working on the account and the tour had started is when the first Michael Jackson child molestation allegations happened. So I became a publicist by fire. So basically, when the story broke, it was a huge story at the time. Some of you guys probably weren't even born when it happened. But when the story happened, it was huge at the time. And everybody else that was on Michael Jackson's team was on a plane on their way from LA to Bangkok, Thailand. So I was the only person that anybody could call to find out anything and to give any commentary about what was going on with Michael Jackson in this child molestation scandal. So that was, obviously it was pretty scary, but at the same time, because I had...
So that was before free Wi-Fi on the plane?
That was before Wi-Fi, period. That was before, that might have even been before the internet.
I'm in denial.
What?
So... I have a 94, what's that? I'm trying to stay.
So that was really a birth by fire. Yeah. So I remember that day because of, you know, everybody calling me from CNN, from Entertainment Tonight, from the LA Times. I was quoted in the LA Times as the only person we were able to get in touch with about this story was Courtney Barnes, and he didn't say anything. So that was, and all my friends were calling me the next day like, oh my God, you're working with Michael Jackson, and I read your name in the LA Times, and you didn't say anything. I was like, that's right, that's what I was told to do, not to say anything. So that was really a birth by fire. So I've gone through so many different tragic situations after that, from dealing with the death of Aaliyah, who was a client at the time that she died, to Brandy's car accident, which, you know, that was one of the first huge stories on TMZ. I just remember waking up and getting a call from somebody at Extra at the time, who Extra and TMZ at that time shared an office that was right next to one another. And my friend from Extra said, so what is it about this car accident that Brandy's had? And I was like, what are you talking about? And then I looked up at my TV, breaking news, Brandy killed somebody in a car accident, and I'm like, oh my God. And I literally had just got out of bed, so I had to literally get out of bed, grab my laptop, and go to work, like immediately. You know, I've had some funner PR experiences, like the Ray J and Kim Kardashian sex tape. That was an interesting one that I've worked on over the course of years.
From whose perspective?
Huh?
Who is the client, Ray J or Kim?
Ray J. Oh. Yes, absolutely. So, you know, I've had some very interesting experiences, but all of that to say, so much of it was the temperament, the learning curve, the not freaking out, the, you know, just taking a moment and breathing and doing something that's very, very practical. When all of those things broke, all of those things brought me back to that very first day with the Michael Jackson thing. It really set the table for it's never gonna get any bigger and it's never gonna get any worse than this. So again, that's why I say if you're gonna intern, if you're gonna go out there and try to get some experience, do it with a person where you can actually see them operating at the absolute highest level, because it is going to help you at the end of the day. I mean, you listen to Lorianne talk about Puffy and, you know, Andre Harrell and all the great people that she's worked with. Those guys were really innovators of their time, and I'm sure that many of the lessons that she learned during those very early heady days of people experimenting with records and how to break these artists into the mainstream, because they were very, you know, it was very much of a separation back then between urban and pop. And watching all of that, I'm sure, helped her to, when she got a Lady Gaga, she knew exactly what to do. It was very easy at that point. Second nature. So, you know, when you go through all of those different experiences with different artists of different levels, it just becomes part of your second nature, and it just helps things from a career standpoint to go a lot smoother.
You know, and Courtney's like super amazing, like he's being gentle on himself, but the thing is, like, a publicist can really define the very reason why artists are in this business. We're not real artists. Don't know a shit or a thing about being politically correct. And unfortunately, the gatekeepers want you to be politically correct. The level of ass-kissing and bitch-assness in the music industry is unbelievable, and it's always been that way, right? Because sometimes the money is intimidated by the fact that you can hit that note, sing that melody, play that key like that. And they see that as power, but we don't. We just are so thankful to God that we can wake up and do it every day. So there's an innate pull. There's a war that you hit immediately when people can't understand what you do. And they don't understand the reaction you get from the world. And they want that power and that sense of power. Where for you, it's not about power. It's about living in that gift. But what happens is artists begin to drink the Kool-Aid and dilute the very power of maintaining the authenticness and the gift. So then when they make the wrong moves, now they gotta drink the bitch assness Kool-Aid and hope that they survive. But what you wanna do is maintain that strength so it's always about your gift, right? Because then they can never remove you or destroy you. But when you're in the battle, the one person that does save your life is the knowledge of a publicist on a team. Because when people don't know you and they don't know how to be leaders themselves. When that record defines how you leave your house in the morning, right? And now someone's telling you that they're really this. And it's an accident that you can't speak to every single person that bought your album, 15 million people. How do you tell them that you didn't really say that in the interview? You know, you say, Adam, when Puff Daddy picked up the chair and I had that big thing. I remember you said, why did you go and press charges? I was like, my father raised me and he scared me. I don't care. And, you know, I had people telling me my career was over. It didn't even start. Mm-hmm. And I was crushed because everybody said I was crazy. And it wasn't that I was crazy, it was that I was passionate.
A little crazy too.
Well, if you cut my crazy up in one episode that we really shot over 2 months, and I'm yelling at the girls, live your life! Don't do it like that! Because you're great. And you leave me out saying, because you're great. And you cut me 30 minutes at the height of my fight for you. Because what you don't want to do is see an artist fail with what I do. I always tell people I'm like Custom Motto. Custom Motto had to produce Mike Tyson. Because who else could manage that gift? When he died, he bit people's ears. That's how instrumental Custom Motto was in a great fighter's life. You can't have Michael Jordan without Phil Jackson. And it wasn't about the sport, it was about teaching you about how to play, how to mentally maintain the gift. So I'm the coach to the biggest superstars on the planet because I can deal with living in the purple, right? What's the purple? I don't know. Come to me with the word one day. Try to talk to Puff Daddy for an hour and get him out on the stage. But it's a world that we protect, right? So when you're edited like that, and I'm passionate and I'm trying to give it to you because if there's one person in that room that anything I say at the very defining moment of your career, you remember and it makes a difference and you go on to sell 15 million albums, then by golly, Miss Molly, this is what I love to do. Shoot me. Or don't. Make your dream come true. You know what I mean? So I've experienced the power of the proper PR, and right now in the business, that's suffering too, you know? Because right now it's all about image, with no substance behind it, but Courtney was part of that magic where, you know, your image was so well protected that it could always be about the music, and that people didn't have to tell you their personal life, or they weren't editing you so that they would get a reaction. They were editing you to tell the truth about your gift, you know what I mean? And then when it became about sensationalism to sell records, and it's always been about that a little bit, but the music still took precedence over sensationalism, you know?
It's rare that that's the case now, though.
Very rare.
Ben is going to chime in, though, and tell us.
Why, Ben?
Why?
That's actually a great segue, because...
Sensational? Okay, wait. Let's rewind two sentences about the sensationalism really quickly, considering that you also work with Lady Gaga.
Yeah.
Because...
She had great records, too, though.
She started with great records.
Right. Well, she started with records that weren't on the album. She got developed first, and then she wrote Just Dance.
Sure.
The one record that spoke to me was Paparazzi. And when I asked her what it was about, you know, sniffing cocaine and some other shit. And I was like, no, do you hear that melody? I'm your biggest fan, I'm fighting you until you love me. Paparazzi. I was like, I ain't about to live my life about no cocaine, girl. We gotta make this shit about something else. Yeah. This melody is amazing! What is that? You know what I mean?
Hi, my name is Ben Madahi. Born and raised in LA. Hi. I'm from LA, born and raised. Started playing piano at age 5, quit piano at age 6, started playing drums at age 7. I was a drummer in the LA Junior Philharmonic for a little while. Quit that because when you're the third best drummer in the Philharmonic, you really don't get shit to do other than play the triangle. And you have to carry a whole lot of bass drums and timpanis around to play the triangle for 5 minutes out of a 4-hour rehearsal. So I was like, that's definitely not what I wanted to do. So I quit and I started DJing. DJing was great for me because it taught me a lot of things about the music business. It taught me a lot of things about artists in general. It taught me how to control a crowd. It taught me how to promote myself, invest my money, reinvest my money into my own business, how to negotiate with people. I was doing a lot of work for a lot of Persian parents. I'm Persian, so I was DJing like a lot of bar mitzvahs and stuff, and negotiating with Persian parents is really, really hard. So I had a really good school to learn about negotiations and contracts and so forth and so on. Fast forward to college, I went to USC. I studied music industry and political science. I started producing music in college. From that point forward, I was managing DJs and producers in college because I wasn't the best producer, and they were much better than me, and I was much smarter than them, so I figured I'll just be a manager. I didn't really know what A&R was at the time, but I was actually kind of like by default A&Ring, because I figured if I was a manager that cared about my client's work, I would like sit with them and tell them what I think could be better and so forth and so on, and tell them who I think these beats could go to. And I didn't know I was doing A&R, I just knew that I liked what I was doing. So for me, A&R and management of producers and songwriters always had the same creative nucleus. They just had kind of different, it's like they're 80% the same, but 20% on each side is like a little bit different. And then graduated SC, started interning at Atlantic Records for a guy by the name of Mike Caron, who's now the head of A&R for Warner Music Group. He started a publishing company called APG, and I was the first employee there. We, at the time that I was there, helped put together songs like, let me think, shit. Right Round for Flo Rida, Airplanes for B.O.B., Whistle for Flo Rida, just a ton of stuff. Timber for
Pitbull. Yeah, Three Times, Chris Brown.
Yeah, Three Times for Chris Brown, thank you. Wild Ones, a lot of Flo Rida stuff because we A&R'd him on the Atlantic Records side of things. So I was doing kind of both. I was doing a publishing A&R job and a label A&R job at the same time for a few years there. Most recently, I A&R'd David Guetta for two albums. I introduced him to Sia. That led to Titanium coming about. I'm one of the two people that discovered Charlie Puth and ultimately signed him. I put him in the room with a client called DJ Frankie, and they wrote the song See You Again together, which was the 12-week number one record from this past summer in the themes of the Fast and Furious movie. Thank you. It's a great, you know, I've been really lucky to kind of be surrounded by really talented people and kind of honed in on what I felt like I was good at from the perspective of just understanding creative people from a songwriting and production perspective. It's the one thing that I think over the last 9.5 years I've actually learned to do pretty well. Because you realize that, you know, especially for songwriters, they don't get paid that often. They get paid twice a year in distributions from their music publishing company. They don't get producer advances like producers get, or paid a ton of money every time a song gets sold. They literally just wait for the money to generate income, and they get paid twice a year. They get one advance from their publishing company, and then they don't see any more advances for years. So it's a really tough job for the people that are really arguably the most important in the songwriting process. So I take their time very, very seriously, and I take my own time very, very seriously, so I make sure that if I'm putting people in the room together, I'm not just like filling up people's calendars for the sake of putting people in the room together, because you know, you're gonna waste their time, I'm gonna waste my reputation, I'm gonna waste my own time making the wrong calls. So I made a pretty concerted effort at really, really understanding like the 100 best songwriters very, very well, and establishing one-on-one relationships with them, whether they had managers or A&Rs or whomever. And I kind of applied that same logic to artists. And with no disrespect to managers or A&R people, but I tell them, if you want me to work on your artist, I don't need to be their best friend. You just need to give me 30 minutes to sit with them and understand what it is that they want, and then I can deliver for you. But if you want me to just shoot in the dark and just tell people in a different city to go into a room together, come write some stuff, and hopefully it'll work for your guys, like, there's not much I can do, you know? And it's worked out pretty well. Because, you know, when people kind of see my track record, sometimes they say, well, yeah, I guess a guy with his track record, if I put him in front of my artist for like 30 minutes, what's the harm? The worst thing is nothing comes of it. And the best thing is that they get a hit record, which improves their touring and so forth and so on. Going back to your, most importantly, just left that company a month ago to start my own company, which is called Unrestricted. Thank you. Thank you. So my company is called Unrestricted. It's a joint venture with a publishing company called Songs. Songs is probably the hottest independent music publisher right now. They have The Weeknd, they have Lorde, they have Diplo, who's Jack U and Major Lazer, and one of the biggest DJ producers out there right now. He also produced the Justin Bieber, Where Are You Now, et cetera, et cetera. They have Chromeo, they have DJ Mustard, who's the biggest urban producer right now. So they have a really stellar roster, and I'm responsible for doing A&R for Chromeo. It was a super cool, I don't know if you guys know them, some of you, if you do, you're a fan. You know, that's kind of the way that it goes with Chromeo. And I'm kind of trying to take them from a place of underground electro-funk pop retro coolness to pop hits that maintain their credibility, which is where I think, you know, you really hit it on the head with kind of being transparent and authentic about your live show and so forth and so on, how you message yourself on stage, because these are guys who will not have a hit record, but still, you know, 4,000 people will show up every time they do a show in a major city, and that's pretty crazy. And you got to perform well in order to be able to do that. And you, sorry? Fancy footwork, exactly. So they're amazing guys, and if you don't know them, my goal is for you to know them in 2016 by coming out with a really big hit record that works for them. And Mustard is an awesome producer. He had like 20 hit records last year, something crazy like that.
Yes, he's
like one of the most, like, went on a crazy run, like, ever since like Little John or Scott Storch, or, you know, from the urban music perspective. As far as going back to a team, there's, you know, I think that teams are changing. I think the labels, also going back to Lorianne's point, like, there isn't as much money to invest in artists and artist development. And I fortunately come from an artist development background. And it's funny because I'm actually starting a company that is based, it's the first time I'm speaking about it publicly, but why not?
Yeah.
An artist development company, which is interesting because it came from an experience where I always considered myself a manager, which I am, of producers and songwriters, but I wanted to branch more out into managing artists. Now, I can manage DJ producers, which is actually how I met Jen, but I tried managing
DJ Felly Fell, yeah, Power right. 106.
Yeah. I did used to manage Felly Fell on Power, but I started managing an artist on a major label 6 months ago, and basically came to the conclusion that, like, fuck this. Like, from the perspective of, like, look, my skill set is to be very, very creative and to know lots of different people and lots of talented people, like the people we have here on stage. Yet, I don't want to start arguing with people about how much money do you have for hair and makeup and, you know, which articles should you do interviews for, and, you know, sorry, which magazine should you do interviews for? And, like, you know, I actually do like the live show and creating kind of like the live element of it, because I think that it's creative and it connects the music to the live. I like creative shit, but if it's like, there's a lot, if it's not creative, I don't want to fucking be a part of it. And I just realized that as a manager, with DJs and producers, it's not as intensive to be able to, like, you know, they're a DJ. It's like you create kind of like a stage presence, and then they go up, they don't need to sing, you know, they just rock a crowd, play other people's music, and leave. They don't even sing on their own records majority of the time. Exactly.
But which is still, like you said, art form in itself, because if you don't know how to take that crowd on a journey, then it's just
absolutely right.
And leave me alone. You know?
But dealing with singers, not so much my thing.
Well, because you finally got the conference calls, but they go, 20 people on a conference call. Is Bob on yet? No, he's hand-holding for so-and-so. All their assistants are holding for so-and-so. Dick in hand, right? I'm holding for so-and-so. And, like, you got to wait till whoever's the biggest shit gets on at the last second,
the last
right?
One, right? I think that when it comes to artist management, I basically came to the realization that, like, I want to be really knee-deep in the creative, and I don't really want to be, and I'm going to get to how this relates to the team in just a second. But I don't really want to do anything that's not creative. I don't really give a shit about the rest of that. So what I decided is I'm going to start a company that will essentially just do that, which is like an artist development company. And since there is a lack of great A&Rs in the business today, I feel like I can find someone new,
right?
Cut a deal with them and say, hey, listen, you know, I want 10% of everything you do for the next so-and-so many years, and we can, like, you know, scale it down. But you need someone to introduce you to all the best songwriters, producers, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You need someone to help you get a record deal. You got to find a great manager. Let me be that person. I know them all. You know, find a great publicist, find a great lawyer, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and bring all those people onto your team, and let me quarterback your shit. Let me lay out the plan for you. And we can, look, if it means meeting, you know, 10 different managers or, like, going through one or two, I'll always be on your team. I'll permanently be there, you know, and I'll be your A&R too. And I think that kind of model. I've seen some artists do that model, which I really like. Like David Guetta has a deal with some other DJs where like he gets a piece of everything these other guys do and he doesn't manage them. But he's like, oh, you know what? Go do your own publishing deal wherever you want. I don't care. Like, I'm just going to get 10%. Go tour all over the world. Find and, you know, book with any promoter or booking agency. I don't care. I'm going to get you opportunities. I'm going to get you notoriety. I'm going to put you in touch with the right people. And he's going to get an override or a meaning of a piece of whatever these artists get because he's going to help develop. And I like that. I like that. Where it's like you're really involved and you get to do the shit that you want to do, but you don't have to like go on the road for 3 weeks with the artist, kind of like staying in Best Westerns, because that's not what I'm going to do. Because I hate that shit. Anyway.
That's the value of the music business in the future, because now there are so many different people who know a little bit of something about the music business. But when you can go to a place that I was saying earlier with an artist development team like what you're talking about developing, where you have somebody who, like he said, he knows every big manager that's in the business. He knows all the great songwriters and producers. That has extreme value. There's a lot of value because as an artist or as a producer, you could kick around this business for years and years and years and never go anywhere because you don't have the right connections.
Yeah, and that's kind of what I like to be. I like to be the hub. Because do I want to deal with all the day-to-day details or even like even some of the bigger picture management details? No. But do I want to help sit and make your album with you? Absolutely. Do I want your show to look amazing and hire someone like Lorianne or someone like Courtney? Absolutely. I want to be the person to introduce. I do that all the time for free. Just as a nice guy, and I've gotten people tons of money and helped them in their careers, and I figure out now I'm at a point where I can cash in on doing that, but not just kind of do it in one email intro, but actually be a part of that person's team going forward. So, Jenna,
this is actually, you guys really set it up for us to kind of go into the part two, because now you guys all know the breadth of experience we're working with here at the table. But I love that you guys kind of all gave a perspective of, I think everybody's very aware that there is kind of like the then music business and the now music business in whatever way, shape, or form you want to take that. Not negative or positive, just what it is. But what it all still comes down to is music plus shows plus fans equals career. If you don't have one of those three things, you might have a spark or whatever, but something is going to fall short. And once you have music plus shows plus fans equals career, then the questions become the next layer of maybe part two of this panel, where we get into the nitty-gritty of how do you monetize and how do you build a brand. So, but right here, what we're talking about is if you don't have those elements, and Lorianne's part goes to connecting with the fans. The music is what starts it all. The shows, getting out there, and then protecting what we all said is so important to present a consistent image that all has to go with fan building, et cetera. Once you have that, then you're already set up for someone if people want to ask later, well, sorry, when do I need an attorney? When do I need a business manager? Well, I tell the whole class, first of all, no businessman wants to talk to you when you have no money. So that's a very easy question. But when do you need an attorney? When will a good manager want me? When will a booking agent, when is the right time for me to meet someone or try to showcase for them? It's when this is all solid. And that's what online has taught us, is that if you can take music and you can connect with fans, then you have a chance. If you can take a live show, like we just gave examples of people who don't have hit songs, but they found a way, whether it's through the DJ festival world or through just the old school coming up, just playing show after show, and they got a big social media following, and that's the cool show to go to. If you can take your show, connect with fans, you can still have a chance at a career. We could go into sync and some other things, but those are the two main ways. So then after that, it's like, okay, are you building a brand? And if so, then you continue and go to different levels of greatness. And or are you able to monetize, which is how you engage these other members of the team? So what I wanted to do with kind of the rest of our time with our questions I want to pose and then get into Q&A is just kind of go through that basic cycle, which brings us back to Ben, of if you are at whatever level, you know, we want this to be relatable, whether it's, you know, for yourself as you're the artist or whether you're on the business side where maybe you're going after a bigger artist.
finding the right song and figuring it out, whether you're coming in, like, where are my songwriters, Amber, and where is Caitlin at? Where is Caitlin? Oh, there you are. Hi. Okay. So, you know, these guys, ladies, have their own sound that they are going to come in the door with. But what is the process here? And this is actually a nice little timeline, because first you're going to hope to meet a Ben type guy, or you're going to hope to meet somebody who knows Ben, and you're going to take what you have coming in. And even if you're Drake or Beyonce, guess what? You have to figure it out every album. You have to figure out, I got to call up the creative team. Beyonce is going to lock them away in a top secret writing camp. So everyone, this is a process every time. This is not just a new artist process, but it applies. Then you're going to have to figure out, okay, what am I selling this time around? What's my image? Whether it's one picture, whether it's the whole theme of your Instagram account, whether it is some, you know, novelty aspect that you want to bring, and then your story. And that's something I think Courtney is always very specific. If you don't have a story to sell, you can't translate, and he can touch on that. And once you figure those things out, or maybe Lorianne, maybe all these three knew each other the whole time, which is where team synergy is really amazing, because then they can figure it out faster. Mm-hmm. But let's say you go through these stages, you hope that you meet a Lorianne that then says, oh my gosh, you've created this amazing music with Ben. You got with your Jennifer as the manager, of course, with Ben and Courtney, and we have all masterminded who you're going to be to break out, and then you're out there with it, and then you meet Lorianne.
And then I throw up and I spit it out and I say, they're all wrong. Who are you really? And then it comes out like you guys see it.
We break it all down and we see if it's all right, and we test it by fire, and then we go out and we say, okay, this is really ready. So that's kind of like the cycle. And once we get to that, then we're at just levels of like, are you going to radio with your record? Are you going to be that cool hipster person that's just targeting blogs, and you're on Hype Track and Fader every week, and you're just super buzzing and cool, you know? Or are you on the major press circuit where you're MTV and you're on Fallon and you're this and that, you know? And then from there, you're doing deals. Maybe you already got a deal. Maybe you did a publishing deal, but not a record deal, because you want to stay indie. Maybe you did a record deal, but not a publishing deal, because you want to hold out. So that's kind of the life cycle, just to give you guys kind of like the big picture.
Most artists will come in with a lawyer.
Really?
Well, most artists that I'm looking at signing come in with a lawyer. Yeah. I would say half. Half,
really?
Or over half, yeah.
Yeah, I guess that's the new judge.
Yeah, it is the new judge. That's it.
So can we go step before maybe how they got to that attorney before they got to you? But
Because they're in a circle of people who
want to get paid off your gift.
Are successful. And, you know, talented people stick together. There's lots of stories of artists who are friends before they ever became popular. And lawyers are one of the first people that will, they kind of A&R themselves, honestly. Actually, I left a meeting with like seven lawyers this morning at a very well-known law firm that they're really cool guys, have good taste, and I'll listen to anything they send me, because they kind of like pre-select, they know if someone's music sucks, like then I'm not, you know, they're not going to send it to me. So like sometimes I really rely on the lawyers, believe it or not, to send me shit. Myman Greenspan. And it's, they just have a lot of really high quality clients. They represent J-Lo, they represent Meghan Trainor, they represent Jason Derulo, so forth and so on. But they,
They're the new It guys.
Right, but those artists make money, and it's a music publisher, that's what matters, and, you know.
They're the new It Zhuzh on the block, those guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, uh-huh.
But, you know, representing the left of center guys can be great too, but it's really, really hit or miss in that world. Right. You know what I mean? You're either Weekend or Lord, or you're some obscure fader blog act that no one's ever heard of and no one cares about. You know what I mean?
I'm so glad that's you said so that.
Yeah, I mean, but that's okay. You either become huge. It's feast or famine.
It's the story of my life. Everybody wants to be on Fader, or they want to be in Complex, but, you know, I'm trying to get you in Vanity Fair.
Yeah, or you could be Jason Derulo and kind of be like a B-level pop star, but still have a very good career and, you know, make money, and his music makes money. You know what I mean?
Shady.
So
shady. Y'all are fierce.
Derulo's not Usher. Justin Timberlake.
And that's the problem. You know, and that's not a problem. But when you get into a system that's defining you before you really have a chance to continue to define and develop your gift, what it does is it speaks limitations. So you got to be careful about what you're taking in as an artist. Because that's a route, this is a route. The routes and the roads, there's really no definition to getting to your destiny, right? This is all option. So what someone else has done, you learn, you write it down, but you still do not fear an original road that you might take. You know what I mean? So for me, this is great. This is school. This is information, and this is it. But at the end of the day, you still have to find a level of belief in yourself that even if you don't get to the lawyer first, but there's somebody at someone's restaurant and you're waitressing and you're like, hey, I'm a songwriter. You sing the song. I don't know. You take a chance and you give them something, or you just take the card or whatever. There's still that is still working.
That today. I've actually have a, that exact story,
ooh,
which
come
I can
on,
tell you.
Somebody.
So Dr. Luke has a house in Hawaii, in Kauai, in Hawaii. And Dr. Luke being like one of the biggest songwriter producers out now. If you don't know him, I don't know if you should even be sitting in this room right now. But so him and his he flew out a bunch of writers to go work with him 2 weeks ago to his house in Kauai. Private, and I didn't get to go, but whatever. The point is that there's a restaurant called Healthy Hut, and these guys would go eat at Healthy Hut every day. And Luke, not a lot of people know what he looks like. So it's not uncommon to say, like, you know, they would know the name, but not what the guy looks like. And so they would go eat there all the time, and they kept talking about music and talking about music. And the woman from behind the counter said, like, I hear you guys talk about music all the time. Are you in the music business? And they're like, yeah, well, kind of. Yeah. She's like, well, I'm a songwriter, not knowing that these are all songwriters. Wow. And Dr. Luke sitting there. And they're like, oh, well, we're songwriters too. Can you play us some of your songs? Or she asked, can I play some of your songs? So that tenacity to, like, if you have it, any opportunity you can take, whether it's meeting a producer in a Healthy Hut in Hawaii, or meeting a lawyer, or meeting an A&R guy, or your cousin's friend is so-and-so, like, any single person that was into music I met, any single person that was working at a label I met, oh, you want to meet me at, like, you know, in fucking Santa Clarita Valley at like 11:45 p.m. Yeah, I'll be there. You know, you want to meet it for like a 5 a.m. breakfast in like San Diego? Sure. You know, like, didn't matter, because like I did whatever I had to do to meet everybody I could to be able to really hustle my ass off so I could just build my name person by person by person. Literally, I love to say that my career and my reputation, and I don't often like to speak on it, but I really do believe that it's built brick by brick. Built meeting by meeting, person by person, email by email, carefully crafted emails to make sure that I'm not ever rude or mean or inconsiderate to people. I don't ever write people off, or I don't ever feel like I'm too good to do something or too good to treat people right. And it's funny, because when I left my company that I was at before, you know, the company itself has its own stigma, and I'm not saying it's a bad place, it's actually a fantastic place, and Jen and I worked there for a little bit together, and you know, it's a really good place, and they're actually one of the best creative places in the business. But they do have a stigma for being kind of like, you know, tough with songwriters and a little bit, you know, aggressive on deals that they do. But when I left, I met with a lawyer who I was never able to get a meeting with before and never did a deal with us before. And I finally had this meeting with this lawyer, and he said, you know, it's impressive because I called a few people about you and they all had raving reviews about you regardless of the place that you came from. And you seem to come out relatively unscathed from that place. And it's such a stark contrast between you and the place that you worked. And I mean, I took it as a compliment. I actually don't think very negatively of the place that I came from, but I understood what he meant. And I guess the fact of the matter is that, like, when you do treat it brick by brick and you're not just like a social climber, but you treat people with respect and you really take every opportunity possible and you really, like, thank people for their time, whether they're an intern or whether they're the CEO of a company. Now I can call any president of any record label. There was a time when I couldn't do that I was like, oh my God, if I met, you know, Peter Edge, oh my God, like my life. Now I'm like sending him records for his artists, you know what I mean? And, or if I could, like, you know, I said to myself, one day if I could work with Puff, I would, like, oh my God. And then I worked on a record with Puff and it was a hit. And I was getting emails from him, and it was he featured on it. It was called Get Buckin' Here with DJ Felly Fell. But the point is that I was like, oh my God, I was getting emails from Puff. I'm like, holy shit, you know? And I think that just kind of putting the good energy out there and following up on every single email, every single opportunity, every single meeting, and you know, 90% of the meetings that I took went nowhere. 10% of them went somewhere. 99% of the emails that I answer probably don't go anywhere. It's that one email that I was kind of like hesitating on answering on when I was trying to say like, who's Saya and why should I care? You know? And oh, she's the girl that sang the theme song or the ending credits to Six Feet Under. All right, whatever, I'll meet with her. And I said, why don't you try writing a song for Beyonce or Alicia Keys? And she wrote Titanium. And I was like, whoa, I didn't know you could sing like this. She's like, yeah, well, you know, I don't really sing. I do more down-tempo, chill stuff. And I'm like, it's like, what if I never responded to that email? What if I never followed up on that? We had two hits together. I'm still close with her. Now she's a huge artist, and people know that I'm close. I wrote a song with her that got nominated for a Grammy. It's like, whoa, if I never responded to that email, my life would have been completely different.
Thank you for being here. So for all of you guys, how do we go about finding the right team, making contact, and then standing out enough that they want to work with us, especially if, you know, we're up and coming?
First, be good enough, because when you do actually get in touch, you gotta like blow them away. And if you're not better than the people that they're already working with, or better than people that are similar to you in your lane of whatever it is that you're doing, every artist is individual, but if you're not better than people that they already have access to, they're not gonna most likely wanna work with you. How do you get in touch with them? There's a way. If you can't figure it out, then I don't know what to tell you.
Because so many more ways than there ever used to be. Yeah. Twitter and Facebook.
Shout out to my staff right here behind you guys, Steven and Christina. If you can find them after, they can CIA find anyone's contact info in this business, like between LinkedIn, between people's personal websites. They're not going to give you all our secrets, but yeah, that kind of goes back to what are you going to say? What are you going to send, though?
Yeah, and your shit just has to be A+. And who your team should be, my general answer for that is the people that are the most passionate, and other people who represent people in your lane. Because let's just say you're an alternative R&B singer like Alessia Cara, right? And let's say hypothetically she's like, I'm looking for a manager, who should I go to? Well, it wouldn't be a bad idea to go to Sal and Cash at Manage the Weeknd, because probably a lot of the smaller stuff that the Weeknd's turning down could go to her. You know what I mean?
And she could be the opening act for the Weeknd.
Exactly. And so there are a lot of opportunities because you'll share a fan base, and because you share a lot of, like, maybe not the same aesthetic and certainly not the same music, but you share a lot of commonalities between those other artists. It's easier for that person to get you work, to get you opportunities, to get you a record deal, so forth and so on. So to be completely honest, I would at least start with people that represent those who you really admire, who you really want to be like, because they have all the right relationships to get you probably to where you want to be and opportunities. And that's a good starting place. Maybe you realize, oh, I met with them and they're not right. But
and you know. Some of you guys are really studying your music and really honing your craft a lot, which is great, but you have to remember that this is the music business. So there is a whole other business side that is just as important as being a great musician.
Yeah. And so to survive that sling and sorrow, like just the way you walked up to the stage, I was like, ooh, I wonder what his music sounds like. Right. So when you have that, you begin to evolve it. You begin to understand it. Now, your music is good. You become, you gotta be the best at what you're producing, right? Then you elevate the way you walk, right? And you leave the house, and this whole thing is performance to you. This is business, but you want to give them the experience. When you go see him, you want to walk in the room. If you don't want to talk loud, like I talk loud, but as an artist, I might be like, like Janet, because now they got to come in like this. And there's an aura that they produced at Motown Records when they taught you as an artist. You sound like get a little accent. Nicki Minaj. Where the hell did that come from? You're experiencing me, art, right? So even with your managers and the people you want to go meet, The stars know how to walk in a room and be it from the door opens. That's their job. Once you find that team, you collaborate with people. You don't want to do what they do. And if they can believe in you, is what he's saying, then you can remain in the gift. And then together, you can strategically take the business and make a really strong career for yourself.
Because
you
have to be it. Like, when I start working with artists who they want to be like this person or that person, but they don't have what that person has, I am turned off immediately.
Yep.
You have to be the best and the most original you that you can be.
Absolutely. I'm going to end off by saying this, that people like Lorianne and myself are like yin and yang, and people like Courtney are actually going to be more and more and more important as time goes on. Lorianne has the visual and the visual representation of everything. I do kind of like the sonic representation of everything. I've seen people that come in and do all those things, and then they don't have the music. And then it's like, well, that's, you know, I can't help you there, right? Because if they're not at least a good writer or producer, have a vision sonically for what they want, but they have, you know, the haircut and the wardrobe and can dance and can do all this shit, it's nice, it's great, it's a great package, but there's nothing inside that package, you know?
Well, no, you're talking about my competitors.
No.
Because my package visually is only about finding that real thing.
But
that
you probably only work with really great artists.
Absolutely.
Too. You couldn't take someone that doesn't have it internally, and you know, you can give them the visual as much as you could, but if they don't have it, they don't have
it. No, I could do it if the entire team just
Burning
wants to
Ben
make
question
money,
before
right?
he jets out. Go.
No, oh, the last thing I was going to say really quickly.
If you want to be an artist that just wants to monetize and do it for a certain period of time, that's okay, and there's no judgment.
Sure.
But if you want to be great like a CEO, or if you want to understand your place, that's a different head. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So without judging it, those are two different perspectives, because everybody wants someone that wants to play the game and make money. So we might
But
have
and there's
that.
Also the person that has the songs and then they become a songwriter because they never transitioned to artists. So
Whitney Houston was not a songwriter.
And neither
right.
is
the
Rihanna.
The greatest right. freaking female vocalist, stop it. But the way she sang your song, I just did a tribute to Kenny Babyface Edmonds on the Soul Train Awards. Anybody know Kenny Babyface Edmonds in the room? Okay. He wrote Bended Knees. He wrote Brandy. He wrote Take a Bow for Madonna. He found Ariana Grande's sound. He wrote End of the Road. Do you know what I mean? So it's like, plus he wrote his own album. Plus he was L.A. in face. He defined black music at a time like, and is still writing records and is still one of the greatest songwriters of all time. Like the amount of Grammys Kenny Babyface Edmonds has is just unbelievable. Do you know what I mean? And to just work with him last week and to still see his passion about the song. He wrote Superwoman. He wrote Shoot for Whitney. Like, to still see him so passionate. He wrote all of Bobby Brown's records, and the one thing he said he loves the most was to write a record for that star. Not everybody's a songwriter, but some people are just stars.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to understand the levels. You can't corporatize a process just because that's what's been working for the past 5 years. If you are a superstar and you know how to sing a record, then that's gold.
But
not
Ben
saying,
has to
not,
find you that record,
not,
is what Ben is saying.
No, because, I'm not saying he's not, but what I'm saying is the rightness is not just about, people have learned to wear an outfit and get a haircut, and that's the wrong information.
Agreed.
That's not what I'm telling you about artist development. What I'm telling you is if you write a record and you have a dirty white t-shirt on, and there's something about that white t-shirt that you don't want to take off when you go to the meeting of your life, then don't take it off. Do you know what I mean?
As an artist.
When Gaga went to Interscope, they did not like her. They were laughing at her. They didn't understand her. And she called me and she said, Mommy Lori, Jimmy only got me when I jumped on the table and started to become the record. It was so authentic for her, that place, as a natural performer.
So Ben has
saying.
To wrap
I gotta
up.
Go. However, if you email me the question, Jen will give me my email. I got to go.
Okay.
I'm super late.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Hi, Ben. How are you? So I'm an artist, singer, songwriter, and I'm almost done finishing my record. And I did it all independently.
We need a little more from you.
Okay. So I did it all independently, and I'm at a place where I need a lawyer because I have three other people working with me, and I need to make a deal because people are getting, you know, what am I going to get from you? Everybody wants a piece of me, and I've been through other situations where everybody wants a piece of you, and I don't know what the hell I'm doing, you know? Like, I know I'm creating an art, and I love to create my art, and I love to sing.
Sing something.
One of your originals.
One of my originals? Okay. I once was a crying babe. I once was a little child. Oh, I once was a little hungered. Oh, I once was a little pain. But in my mother's arms I lay. In my mother's arms I lay. Oh, her sweet soul.
I'm
at the point where I need a team. And
great tone.
Yeah, exactly.
And it finds it
so
hard.
So who are the people who want the piece of you, or just give us a little?
Well, the people I'm making a record with. And then I've also had
producers and songwriters?
Producers. Okay. I'm the songwriter.
Okay, so are you guys a team collectively?
Collectively, like a team. I'm kind of going a little old school. So
No, that's fine. And if they are part of it, you got to remember, fair business is good. It'll come back around to you. You know what I'm saying? As an artist, you need the right producers, you know? You can't have Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis, you know what I mean, without Janet. Like, they define the sound. Unbreak My Heart, Toni Braxton. Like, you can't deny a production team that's creating a sound that your voice is laying in, right? So you have to collectively be okay with that. You know what I'm saying? I think that...
And sometimes when you leave that, the magic leaves right along with it. Just know that.
I guess my question is really, like, I find it hard to, where do I find you guys? Where do I mean, you're sitting
okay,
here
well,
now,
blunt
but.
Okay, well, question, just being completely honest, because everybody who sits on this side has to get paid one way or another.
Yeah.
They're either going to be getting paid as a percentage or they're going to get paid.
I understand
So do
that.
You have a budget that you can come in and say, look, I have X amount and I need X amount?
Well, that's the thing. It's like a new artist. Like, you go into a restaurant, you want to be a waitress. They're like, do you have 5 years of experience
as
a waitress?
Right.
No, so how are you ever going to become a waitress?
Right.
Well,
no,
you know what
no,
I mean?
I'm telling
like,
you, though,
this
how
is what you
to...
Do they have open mics in L.A.?
Yeah.
You
no, got to
get out there and live it.
That's exactly
no,
that's
I understand.
All you got to do. All of these people trying to define what you do, like it's about moving this cup over here, hasn't done it. You have to get out there and be. You got to wake up and be. What's your name?
Kaylee,
you have to decide to be that song, right? You need work. You need to understand that when someone asks you to sing, within that moment, you got to be so connected to I'm the greatest. This is all I got. I'm going to sing it like this. I'm going to just do what I do.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And the business will come.
Mm-hmm. Right,
but you can't be having these conversations without being able to affect the room, right?
And you're
going to have to give a piece of yourself away.
And you're lucky also that you live in Los Angeles, because there are many other girls that are probably more talented and prettier and more prepared than you that live in Iowa who are 2,000 miles away from the action.
Yeah.
But because you're here, you got to do what Lorianne said.
If you want to run the road and associate yourself with the Red Horn side and get money and sell your soul, that has a cost. But if you want to associate yourself with the lighter side and the brightness and the reason for the season, then that's a different fight. And we don't cohabitate. There's two distinct energies in the music industry. Why? Because music is the quickest way to influence the world. There's a power in influence. And once you have the power to influence, you can get money. So what's attached to that influence is greed. Right? So you have to listen to hear what people say in between what they say. And if you're an artist that wants to understand and be connected to a source of inspiration, to someone that wants to make a Grammy award-winning album, when we first met Adele, she was opening for Alicia 7 years ago. Still giving us Wild Turkey and the Zhuzh. But, you know, she's cultivated that Zhuzh. She understands how to be it. There is a part of performance element. There still is a methodical place where I now have to become part of the business. But her authenticness can never be challenged. I'm just saying that to you because obviously you're blue-eyed soul. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Obviously you can do a lot, right?
I was just going to say that's actually interesting you said that because that's the next thing that people are going to want to know is, and we're totally just picking on you, but for the purposes of the room, you know, and whoever class, get your questions ready. No, not in a bad way. I just mean like we're using this as a great example because we're going really, you know, further and further with your question, but you know, I think that you have to be able to articulate what exactly you want from someone. Like being specific is so important. And from I'm a manager, if I met you and you said I'm working with these producers, like they just said, and you've got to create this team and you do want to make a fair deal, you need to find someone who can put on paper the compositions that you have recorded with X people. You need to, you know about splits. These are all things you can Google, these are all things you can learn. You need to get with your team. You need to say, hey, how are we doing these splits? Because just because I meet you, I'm not going to figure out your splits for you. You guys need to have an understanding of that. And if you can come to an attorney and you can send him an email and say, hi, I have a few dollars, but I would also like you to take a chance on me. Here is my SoundCloud, attaches my photo and bio. I have 6 records done with these people. I'm ready to monetize them via streaming, etc. The splits are as follows. Is there anyone in your firm that could do a basic producer deal for me where I can own these masters? I'm pretty sure you're going to get a response. If any of us got that email, we would literally forward it to an attorney and be like, this girl knows exactly what she wants. If she can scrounge up $600 from her, you know, couple of friends, I might just do her a favor. And that's why you're here, to learn how to say those things. That's why you guys are in this room and you're light years beyond a person that's still just kind of like Courtney said, out there and wherever, or a person that's just, you're investing in your own career already by being here. That's the difference between you sending that email and someone else sending us one of these like incoherent, illiterate emails that we delete every day from our Gmail of people like, I'm a really talented artist and I need beats. Literally, how many of those guys do we get? I mean, we manage one of the hottest producers right now, and we get these like all day long. So if I get your email, oh, someone is replying in our office. So that's the approach.
So you got to learn and understand and think like a businesswoman. But sometimes, too, you might have to give up something to those producers if they're giving you what you want. Just sit down and make it fair.
Right. Yeah, that's.
Do you know what I mean? If it's fair to you, and you know that the work is fair, you can have that handshake.
And honestly, it should still be common sense. It should feel fair, you know? And that is possible to make, like, as they say, a back of the napkin deal, you know what I mean? Where you feel something is fair.
And so, the back of the napkin deal, not to cut you off, we're gonna go on, is always time. If you don't understand, put it into a time. Okay, right. If you don't get the shit done in 2 months, then we all good. We good? We're going to keep these records. I'm going to give you, we're going to split this 60-40.
Term, now, yes, the exactly. Is that it? Yeah, good. No, totally. No, because, but that's such a great point. If you give a window.
Time it out.
And that feels fair, too. Look, if you look at each other and go, look, is this fair? Okay, we put this amount of time. We're going to give this amount of time for this deal to apply. And when it doesn't, then it poof, disappears, and we have to make a new deal.
And another thing Jennifer said, common sense in this business is everything. If as Grace Jones would say, if the fuck don't feel right, don't fuck it. Meaning.
I was gonna go more with the duck thing, like if it looks like a duck, quacks like a duck, but you go with that, okay.
And they're also not artists, because we'll be sitting there like, no, it's a duck, and that motherfucker's an elephant. But we believe in the dream so bad.
Right, that's true.
That
that's
you're
true.
Like, it's a duck.
That's true.
So Mom, when, I so, promise, that's it true. Cracked.
All that to say, when you get a manager, when you're meeting these lawyers, when you're
that's
meeting these publishers, and they're presenting you with deals and scenarios and all that, if it doesn't feel right, don't do it.
Mm-hmm. Right. And why are you even talking a deal? You need to talk to people like, we haven't sold a record yet. When we sell this record, we can rethink this, but everybody needs to calm down.
Right.
It needs to be realistic. because we don't even know. We think these records are hot, but we don't know what the game is going to tell us. So you need to just pump those brakes, pull it on back, and say, let's get in the game, period. You know what I mean? Because you're going to have to take a few bumps and bruises, and I've taken some. And, you know, and if I did have the capacity to have learned earlier, I think at an earlier game, I could have switched my game up. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So the knowledge is important.
But you're right where you're supposed to be, Lorianne.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank God for, you know, youth and water and cocoa butter and stuff, because I can still kick this leg.
Okay, Emily, question. Go.
Hello. My name's Emily. I'm in Jen's class studying music business. So I have a question for everyone, and each answer will probably be kind of different because it's different worlds. But so how do you handle a situation where you
and
have...
And Emily is a manager already.
Yeah,
of her
I help some of my friends out.
Right. Got, so she's on the business side.
Yeah. I have, like, connections in the small underground indie LA scene, but nothing higher yet. So how do you handle a situation where you have this like great vision for your client, but they're clashing with you and they want to do something that you know is going to make them crash and burn? How do you handle that and get them on your side successfully and hopefully peacefully?
That's you,
Courtney.
I
go.
Well,
I get fired.
I mean, sometimes you have to let them crash and burn. Mm-hmm. You just do. I mean, I'll give you a perfect scenario. I have an artist that you guys all know named Cisco, who was at the time one of the hottest artists out there. Everybody thought he was the next Michael Jackson, and he did so many different things. From he wanted to fly all the time during his live performances, and we didn't have a Lorianne around, so they strapped his ass up and he flew on a few award shows. Some of you may have seen it. He would go on radio stations and he would just absolutely go nuts and lose his mind. And sometimes you just have to let them crash. That's an example in a big picture where it has a real serious long-term effect, because now he's completely immaterial to the business. But you're in the world that you're in right now. It's okay for the artist to make some mistakes, because, you know, it's like we're in the internet age now. Like, you can make a mistake and you can do something really bad right now, and then 20 minutes later you can do something really great that could be just as big of a story as the bad thing that you did, and everybody's forgotten about the bad thing you did. So
let me ask one question though, based on our little chart. So is this artist still in that 0 to 1, are they ready to go? Like, is this early in their career, or is this someone who's already out and they're working and you're seeing that they could go up, but it looks like they're gonna go down?
Well, it could be either one. I mean,
okay.
Okay,
where are you having the disagreement? In their live show, or in what they wear, or like in what areas?
Well, records. It could be anything. It could be so they want to go do something and you know it's gonna be bad for their image.
Well, I think Courtney
gave you
the best advice. Mm-hmm. You can think about it, right? Because now that I've learned, I understand how to say, well, why do you want to do that? Mm-hmm. Right? And then you just sit here. Why do you want to do that? Okay. So what is the inspiration behind that? Mm-hmm. And then you give them the ego, you give them the floor, and he goes, well, because I think I'm like this, and oh, woo-dee-woo. Okay, well, I think that because you're so genius at being the leader of moving the crowd, I'm not getting Barnum and Bailey. I'm getting this time in your life where you don't have to have a number one record, where you have written a legacy of music. I think we don't need to feel that pressure. I think we need to, do you know what I mean? I'm talking about a really super big icon who I have to still be like. But if you believe in that artist and you know they're great, then you pull back and you don't let that ego come in, but you begin to have another level of a conversation with them, and that's where you're a great manager or a great creative director or a great collaborator.
Otherwise known as the Jedi mind trick.
I like to call it that. I like to.
No, play. We all do it, though. But it's approach.
But I don't
it's
come
approach.
From that energy. I come from a place where I'm an artist as well, so I understand the vulnerability and the insecurities that come behind putting your blood, sweat, and tears into music, into a song. and having an idea, right? And having to put yourself out there in front of all you strangers. You could walk away from here and say, that girl's crazy. Or you could walk away from here and say, she's whatever. But I have to be secure with me because I know my art. And I have to be secure with feeling that. Do you know what I mean? So it's like, I understand the vulnerability of that. So it's not the Jedi mind trick. It's a sincere place where neither one of us really know. And if I push you and you push me and I tug and we tug, we might make purple rain. And so there's people in the music business that still have that passion, that haven't stripped us of that process. You know what I mean? That haven't said, sit down and say, how did Stevie Wonder write that song? You know what I mean? Like, still love that. How did Mick Jagger, how you at the party still dancing with Mick Jagger? He don't want to dance with nobody but me because he still smells Tina Turner on his breath. And I'm trying to dance and he getting on another rhythm. He's 75. I'm like, shit, this shit is Mick Jagger. I don't give a fuck what I look for. It's art and it's okay, but you have to know that the vulnerability of that is what's more important. It's not the Jedi mind trick. If you really believe in a person, then the trust at an early age is very important, at an early stage is very important. You know what I mean? I feel safe because we've done business with her and I trust her and her students and she's gonna answer any question when I leave to protect my brand. I feel safe because he's up here and he knows I just shifted the whole entire dynamics of the Soul Train Awards. I feel safe because my team is back there. And if you hear something that sounds like a catcall, that's someone from my team telling me to shut up. Do you know what I mean? Trust. So as a manager, if you could rethink the very tension and understand where you're going to be greater than your artist, where you'll be the defining force, you know what I mean, of when, you know, Charlie Wilson couldn't sleep in a hotel because he was black and his manager slept in the car with him, a white Jewish guy, you know what I mean, and stayed up all night, but then the next day they wrote higher and higher. Do you know what I mean? So it's like, you want to be that manager, I feel like.
Definitely.
Okay, so that's what I'm inspiring you to become. Understand the business, but become that. Become Freddie DeMand to Madonna. Become somebody that wants to change the world with what you guys are doing. And also know that underground is mainstream. Don't ever belittle the club that you're making fashion and art in.
Amen.
Walk, like, if you guys have the voice of this culture, then understand that you have to walk around with an idea that says, when you get to the label and you get to these people, you have to walk in the room and say, you've been waiting for me, and it's okay, let's go. They've been waiting for you to arrive. Heck, you've been waiting for me. Press play. As opposed to, how do you like my record? Now that jewel fell out of my crown. Do you understand? But that's after you prepare and you. They don't go in the ring weak.
Right.
They go in the ring knowing the hit, the next hit could knock them out and take their lives. Maybe everybody doesn't get passionate about music like I do, but that's just the opposition that she's giving you guys access to. Because every day could be my last day. So every day I wake up, I don't fall back on a system. I break systems. My art defines an emotion. It inspires a generation to dream and press forth through the oppression, through the challenge, through the hate, through the hypocrisy. So I don't know a man-made system, you know, but that's a lonely place sometimes. So I connect with systems.
One of the biggest things for me is I am in the music business program here, but I am a singer and songwriter, and I'm constantly trying to find the balance between, like, my main passion and then wanting to learn the music business side of it. And I kind of just wanted to get advice from you guys of how to, like, a part of me is like, no, you should be out there performing and singing all the time and giving it your all instead of, like, taking the time to learn the music business aspect of it, compared to there's times where I'm like, no, this is very important and you need to, like, as well learn that at the same time. Is there any advice that you could, like,
give about that? Well, you're here. You're here at this place where you can do both, where it's nurturing both sides of that, of who you are. So, you know, I can't say that one is necessarily more important than the other. You, I mean, you're in a place where you can have all elements, and you're young, so you have an opportunity to, you know, maybe go through it as a artist, singer, songwriter, and maybe that's going to work for you amazingly, but maybe it doesn't, but then you still have that same passion, and you still want to be involved on a creative standpoint with records, and you still want to be in the music part of the business, so then you become a music publisher.
Everything matters. Not one thing is better than the other.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Behind is in front, and in front is behind. They're acting like they're behind, but sometimes they're the bigger stars than the artists. Mm-hmm. Right? In the way that they're gifted and championed as well. Do you know what I mean? But I'll tell you this about the singing. If you wake up and you can't, you will die. Then that's the only energy that should ring clearer. You know what I mean?
So do you think it's, like, not necessarily a waste of time, but if you know that you wake up and you're like, I'm singing, like, that's what I do.
You're doing it right now. You're just... And what you're doing is you're maximizing your knowledge of it and your opportunity. So you don't have to know that answer right now.
Okay.
You're in school, so you're going to learn everything. Right. When I was studying ballet, contemporary, I'm like, there's no way I'm going to be a tree. This shit is like technique. I don't feel like all day I got to be a tree in this modern company and knock my head over the head and jump up and down. That's not dancing to me. But I had to get the technique. You know what I mean? And as a choreographer, I was able to find a beat where there was no beat and give a Lady Gaga a vision and go back to my contemporary theory. And my ballet and my training, and I can tap, river dance, whatever. Do you know what I mean? Twerk, do it all. But I was in school when I was in school. Because the day's gonna come when this is over, and now you gotta go become it, right?
Perfect.
So right now, you don't have to decide now, would be my answer to you. Absorb it all. And each day, work at what your gut and work at your road instinctually. Because the thing that people don't want to tell you, and it is already is in the beginning what it is in the end if you can continue to believe and walk the road. You don't suddenly become. It was destined, you know what I mean? But you begin to craft out and understand as an artist where you fit in this thing, you know what I mean? And like I said, and if you're not that deep and not that creative, there's a place for like a monetizing aspect towards a business. That's great. There's many, many avenues, like jingles, songwriting, commercials, movies. There's like so many things, right?
And but, and today you have many more options than you did maybe when me and Lorianne first got in the business, because to think about being a successful singer, songwriter, artist, you know, back when we were coming along and then transitioning from that into becoming, you know, going to work at a publishing company or being a manager or something like that is kind of like, ew. But now, you know, everybody is playing with absolutely all of their options. So you're not corralled in as you would have been had you been in the music industry 20 years ago. Gotcha. So you definitely have options.
Thank you so much, Amber. Well, I just want to say thank you guys. If anybody, speaking from anybody who is inspired by Lorianne, that has a question that they are going to die if they don't ask tonight, I know I'm going to volunteer to stay for a minute. Maybe they'll stick around for just a couple seconds if anyone wants to run up. But we just want to thank everyone for coming tonight and being here with us. And I just want to really thank them. If everybody could clap it up
for your family. Isn't she amazing? She's amazing.
And thank you, Aaron, LACM, and check back for the next panel to be continued next quarter, and keep it all going.
And if you guys want to connect with me on social media, I am at BoomCack on Instagram and at Lorianne Gibson on Twitter. And I am a snappy, but like if you just want to, you know, maintain the zhuzh, but just also really, you know, get into what I do and who I really am, so that if we cross roads in the future, you will be educated on what I really do and how super powerful I am and passionate about what I do.
And if you didn't figure that out tonight, you
do you guys want to say at all how they can get in touch with you, like DM or Courtney Facebook messages or Lori?
No, Courtney's not taking your call until you get in the shush. Do you know how hard it was for me to get Courtney to work? Like, I would run up to him at every fucking award show as a dancer, like, Mr. Barnes, could you please help me? Right? Am I lying?
Persistent.
Shady, finally. He was like, okay.
Thank you guys so much.